welcome to Highland Baptist Church. We are glad to be with you this morning as you worship in your homes. I want to invite you to join us as we begin worship with I Stand Amazed in the Presence. Would you sing wherever you are this morning?
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
This is one of the more unique Baccalaureate Senior Recognition Sundays we've ever had here at Highland. One of the more unique ones I've ever been a part of, because in years past, we've been able to celebrate our seniors by bringing them up on stage, by giving them a Bible, by giving them a gift from us here at the church, and celebrating this accomplishment of them graduating from high school and moving on to the next stage of their life. However, today, because of everything happening, we're having to celebrate them virtually. Y'all have just watched a video and seen pictures of them as they have grown and matured physically. But what I want to do just for a second is talk about how I've gotten to see them grow and mature spiritually over the last few years that I've been here. I've seen them grow in maturity and go from who they were to the leaders that they are now within our student ministry. I've seen some of our younger students look up to them, ask for their advice on spiritual matters, and I've seen these students excel in every way that they could. It is an incredible opportunity for me to be able to celebrate them today with each of you. And so what I want to do just for the next couple of minutes is kind of tell you a little bit about where they've been and where they're going. The first student that I want to talk about is Amber Michelle Auld. Amber is the daughter of Cassandra Smith and the late John Watson Auld, and she is also, her guardian is Karen Rhodes. She attended Oak Grove High School in Oak Grove, Mississippi, before transferring to Northeast Lauderdale High School, where she graduated from. She plans to attend Meridian Community College before transferring to a university, and she'll be majoring in computer programming with the plans to be a software developer. Her favorite scripture verse is Jeremiah 29:11. And that says, "For I know the plans I have for you," and this is the Lord's declaration, "plans for your well-being, not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope." The next student that we're celebrating is Caitlin Nicole Lever Clayton. She is the daughter of Danielle and Jason Clayton. She attended Lamar High School before transferring to Mississippi School of the Arts, which is where she graduated from. Some of the awards that she's received is that she is a Mississippi Scholar, highest average in acting one, an arts ambassador, National Arts Honor Society, Honor Roll, and Beta Club. She plans on attending the University of Mississippi in the fall, where she will be receiving her Bachelor of Fine Arts in acting. Her favorite scripture verse is Philippians 4:13, which says, "I can do all things through him who strengthens me." The next student we're looking at is Aubrey Lee McCary. Aubrey is the daughter of David and Kawana McCary. She has recently graduated from Northeast Lauderdale High School, and she will be going on to Meridian Community College for 1 year and then transferring to the University of Southern Miss, where she plans on receiving her degree in speech pathology. She is graduating with honors and has been accepted to the Meridian Community College Honors College. Her favorite scripture is John 15:13 that says, "Greater love has no man than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend." And then the final student that we're looking at this morning is William, or Will, as you know him, Knight McCarty. He is the son of Britt and Amy McCarty, and he has attended Meridian Christian Home Educators, where he has just recently graduated from. Some of the stuff that he has been awarded with, some of the awards he's received, he was named Max Preps Player of the Year in Tennis from 2017 through 2019, and he is a recipient of the Trail Life Freedom Rangeman Award. His plans are to attend Mississippi College in the fall to study administration of justice and to play tennis for the Choctaws. His favorite scripture is John 16:33 that says, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Normally, this is the part of the service where I would ask you to give these students a round of applause for what they've accomplished. And since, like I said, we're not in the same room, what I encourage you to do is to reach out to them in some capacity. Maybe a text or an email. Maybe it's just the next time you see them and we're actually able to touch each other, give them a pat on the back or a hug, and just let them know how proud you are of everything that they've accomplished. Because I am, and I know that you are too. So please let them know that.
God promises to lead our paths if we promise to follow him. And so this next song is called "He Leadeth Me." And I hope, graduates, that you will do that very same thing in your next step into college and wherever your journey takes you, that you will always look to him to lead your path. Would you sing with me in your home, "He Leadeth Me"? He leadeth me.
The victory's won from death's cold wave. I will not flee, for by his hand he leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me. By his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Sing it one more time. He leadeth me, he leadeth me. By his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower
Sunday. I hope we're having a fantastic Sunday so far. If you don't know who I am, my name is Miss Libby, and I'm the interim children's minister here at Highland Baptist Church. And I have some cool verses for y'all today. This is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 22. It says this: Rejoice always, pray constantly, give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Don't stifle the Spirit, don't despise prophecies, but test all things. Hold on to what is good and stay away from every kind of evil. Let me read that verse again. Rejoice always, pray constantly, give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Don't stifle the Spirit, don't despise prophecies, but test all things. Hold on to what is good, stay away from every kind of evil. Okay, so those verses had tons of commands, right? Have y'all ever heard of the game Simon Says? In the game Simon Says, there's one person that's it. And that one person will give commands by saying, Simon says, and they're going to say a command. Or they're not going to say Simon says, and they're just going to say a command. But we can only do the command whenever the person that's it says Simon says, okay? And if you don't do the command whenever Simon says it, or you do the command whenever Simon doesn't say it, then you're out of the game, okay? So we're going to play a quick game of Simon Says, and Brandon is going to help us, okay? So Brandon, give us some commands, please.
Simon says, touch your nose. Simon says, raise your eyebrows. Stop.
Aw, man, I stopped, but Simon didn't tell me to stop. I don't know if you stopped, but we're going to stop the game anyways because I can't see you, but I lost the game, so there's no point in going on. So, whenever God tells us a command, we have to do it, right? We should do it because it's God. God made us, right? So let me read all these commands again that God told us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 22. But I'm going to put the phrase, God says, in front of it, okay? God says, rejoice always. God says, pray constantly. God says, give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. God says, don't stifle the Spirit. God says, don't despise prophecies, but test all things. God says, hold on to what is good. God says, stay away from every kind of evil. So when we don't obey God's command, we don't necessarily lose the game, but we move further away from God, right? God gave us all those commands, and he expects us to do it, and we should do it, okay? Because if we don't do his commands, we move further away from him, and then we won't have a great relationship with him whenever we need a great relationship, great relationship with God, okay? Because God made us. God literally created all of us, and he has the best plan for all of us, okay? So let me pray for us. Hey, God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for all that you bless us with. God, I pray that you help us to understand that we need to obey all of your commands, God, because all of your commands are so much better than what other people's are, God. God, I pray that you be with us as we go throughout the rest of this week, and I pray that we glorify you in all that you do. And in your name, I pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, and I'm so glad that you are able to join us this morning. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5. That's where we're going to be this morning. And as you are turning there, I just want to remind us, as we looked at last week, chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, that we talked about how some people may become so fixated on finding out the specifics of God's will and God's plan and maybe God's timetable, specifically when it comes to the topic of Jesus's second coming. In fact, it reminds me of a time that I went to this guy's house, and it wasn't too much longer after he found out that I was a minister that he called me over to the back of his little pickup truck, and he let down his tailgate, and he proceeded to pull out this 4-foot-long tube, and he took the top of it off, and he took out this 4-foot-wide, 6-foot-long laminated timetable in color of Jesus's second coming. Serious. I felt so bad for him because he had worked so hard on this thing. It looked so beautiful, and I just had to tell him that is just a bunch of nonsense. No one knows when Jesus is coming. I mean, in fact, Jesus himself warned us that no one other than God knows the day or the hour of his return. Now, we may not know when God will return, but we can know what God's will for us is while we wait. So, do you know what God's will for your life is? I know of some recent or some graduates that are about to graduate. They're asking that question, aren't they? You know, all of your life you've been waiting on this day to graduate, to come, and it's finally here. And one of the questions that is often on young people's mind is, what does God want of my life? What is his will for my life? That's a great question. In fact, that's what we're going to look at today. You see, whether you are a recent graduate or a parent of a graduate or just one of the many, like all of us, who are in the phase of waiting right now, God's will for us is to live godly lives of faithful obedience. I want you to look at our text this morning. We're going to look at verses 16 through 24. Just read along with me as I start in verse 16. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit, do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. And may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come before you and we just simply ask that you would open up your word to us, that your spirit would guide us into all truth, that you would magnify the work of Jesus, that you would strengthen our faith in you, and you would call the dead to life this morning. We ask this. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So in these 9 verses, there are 7 to 8 commands that Paul puts in here, and each one of these are present commands, meaning that they're to be active in our life each and every day. And so what I want to show you very quickly are 7 ways to follow God's will while you wait. 7 ways to follow God's will while you wait. So let's look at number 1, and we're just going to simply walk through the text this morning, making a few comments along the way. The first that Paul says is to rejoice always. It's always God's will for us to display joy. In fact, Paul said that as he was writing in prison. He's writing to the Philippians, Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. So joy, our joy as followers of Jesus, it is rooted in the Lord, and we can rejoice no matter where we are, no matter what is happening around us, we can be people of joy. But would it surprise you to know that the word joy is not really used that much in the Bible? And it shouldn't be too surprising because the Bible is written to people who are outside of Eden, outside of paradise. But the places that we find joy written are places where we see worship taking place. Because God's presence, when he is with his people, so when God's presence is with God's people, worship happens and joy results. So it would be natural for us to find joy in the Psalms, the hymn book of the Old Testament. It's natural for us to find joy in the tabernacle worship text and then the temple worship text. And then we get to the New Testament, and now God's presence is not located in a temple, but now Jesus himself, the second person of the Trinity, has come to dwell in us. And guess what the message of the angels was? They brought great news of what? Great joy, because Jesus had come. And so Jesus died, and then Jesus ascended back to the Father, and Jesus promised us that he would send the Holy Spirit. And so now God's presence just doesn't dwell with people as Jesus was, but now he is dwelling in people with the Holy Spirit. This is why Paul says that one of the fruit or the fruit of the Holy Spirit in Galatians 5:25 is what? Joy. God's people in God's presence always equals joy. Joy is, one dictionary said, the emotion of great delight caused by something exceptionally good or satisfying, a source of delight. So, what is your source of great delight today? What are you looking to satisfy you? If you find that you're not a very joyful person right now, you don't like all the things that are going on around you and in the world right now, well, the easy answer is spend time in God's presence. True joy is rooted in the person and the work of Jesus. Jesus died for you. Jesus is alive today for you. And no matter what you are going through, no matter how long you have to wait to get to the other side, rejoice always. So Paul says, rejoice always. And the next one that we see in verse 17, that we can follow God's will while we wait, is to pray without ceasing. It's always God's will for us to pray without ceasing. So what did Paul have in mind here? Does he mean that we have to stop everything else that we do in life and just pray? Should we pray with as we drive down the road with our eyes closed? Should we pray with our eyes closed as we walk down the hallways? Should we just move off somewhere into a monastery and become a monk? What does Paul mean here? Well, I love the way that Warren Wiersbe teaches this. He says that this word means constantly recurring, not continuously occurring. What does that mean? Well, he goes on. He says, we are to keep the receiver off the hook. We are to be in touch with God so that our praying is part of this long conversation that isn't broken. Well, I was blessed with this wonderful email from a family within our church this past week. And they helped me to see that, or they were talking about how they took the Ephesians 6:18 challenge from a couple weeks ago. And Ephesians 6:18, Paul reminds us and encourages us to praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. And here's part of the email that I just want to read to you real quick. They go on and they say, after your sermon two Sundays ago, all of my family set an alarm on our phones for 6:18. And this is what has happened. At 6:18, every day the alarms go off and we come together and pray as a family. I made the rule that everybody has to take turns praying. It has been so awesome to watch my kids and husband pray aloud, something they don't like to do. As soon as my alarm goes off every day, I look up and no matter what he is doing, I see our oldest stop and come to the couch. I immediately hear our middle yell with all of his might as he's running to the couch. It's Jesus time, folks. And our youngest will get up and excitedly skip to the couch saying, it's time. My husband comes in from outside and I stop what I'm doing. We all sit around and talk a minute, and then the person whose turn it is prays. It's been so awesome to watch God work in all of our hearts. See, prayer is just simply having a conversation with God. God wants us to pray, not because he demands it and then we have to, but we get to. He loves for us to talk with him. We know that we are talking with someone when we pray that loves us and that can actually do something about our needs that we bring to him. Pray without ceasing. Have an unbroken conversation with the Lord throughout today. Try that. Pray without ceasing. Paul's third way that we could follow God's will while we wait. In verse 18, give thanks in all circumstances. Give thanks in all circumstances. It's always God's will for us to give thanks in all circumstances. Now, prayer and thanksgiving, they go hand in hand here. And we are called, now look at the text. We are called to give thanks in all circumstances, not for all circumstances. We do not, and God does not expect us, for us to thank Him for the tragedy that we just experienced or that we are headed toward. But we do thank God because He is in it with us and what He has or He is accomplishing for us in the midst of our suffering. We just heard this verse a while ago, John 16:33. Jesus told us, you will have trouble. We know that we're going to have trouble. And the trouble that we endure, it has a purpose. Have you ever thought about what the purpose of our suffering is? Well, it could be that it's evangelistic in nature. People watch us even while we suffer, even while we go through that tragedy. We're displaying the reality of Jesus Himself to the world in this unique way. The kingdom of God is displayed when we suffer with this anticipation, as Paul says, the future weight of glory that is coming one day. That when we suffer now, we suffer not because it's fun, but because we know what's coming later. I've said this before, but it bears repeating. Our present suffering, when compared to the coming glory of God, it's just like a bad night's stay at a cheap motel, no matter how bad that suffering may be in the moment. So how do we give thanks in all circumstances? Well, we do it the same way Jesus did. Paul said, or the writer of Hebrews said, that Jesus endured the cross because the joy that was set before Him. We look to the joy, the coming glory of God, that day when Jesus will return as King over everything. So when our mind and our heart is set on this future glory of what Jesus has promised, man, there is no amount of suffering or hardships that is going to steal your thanksgiving. So we can give thanks in all circumstances. But there's a fourth way in which we can follow God's will while we wait. Look at verse 19. Just simply, he says, do not quench the Spirit. Do not quench the Holy Spirit. It's always God's will for us to walk in the Spirit. This word quench, it means to extinguish or to suppress or to douse, to put out, to snuff out, all of those kind of words. And often, most often, it means to extinguish a fire, like if you throw water on it. Some places, though, it means to evaporate or to dry up. And with all of those meanings, there's no doubt what Paul has in mind here. What he's saying is that if we ignore the Holy Spirit's voice long enough and often enough, eventually we will become spiritually hardened and we will no longer be able to hear Him speaking to us. It will be like His voice is just evaporating or drying up and we won't be able to hear it anymore. You know, one of my favorite places for a good summertime drink is Sonic. I love Sonic. And I like the strawberry slush, although I have a new favorite right now. But I like the strawberry slush, and it just really hits the spot on a hot summer day, right? And you probably have your own fruit slush. And have you know the frustration, if you've ever had one of those real fruit slushes, that you have, that when you're trying to drink and be satisfied with this drink, and then all of a sudden this little piece of fruit gets stuck at the bottom of that straw, and no matter amount how much or how much suction you apply, that little piece of fruit is not coming through that little bitty straw. It's so frustrating. Well, this is like the difference between someone who quenches the Holy Spirit and someone who allows the Holy Spirit to have freedom in his or her life. Sometimes people get choked by fears and self-centeredness and resentment. And that suppresses the Holy Spirit from operating and being able to work in that person's life. It's like having this obstruction in the straw. But allowing the Holy Spirit to have freedom in your life, to have control over your life, to remove those, to not quench Him, well, that just basically fills us up with the Spirit, and it leads really to life's sweetness of following Jesus. And so we're not to quench the Spirit. But number five, we see in the very next verse, do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. We're not to despise prophecies. We are to test everything. So it's always God's will for us to listen to preachers, but to examine what they say to see if it matches up with biblical truth. The late New Testament scholar F.F. Bruce, he defines the gift of prophecy as the declaration of the mind of God in the power of the Spirit. The declaration of the mind of God in the power of the Spirit. Eugene Peterson, he translates it this way in The Message. Don't suppress the Spirit, and don't stifle those who have a word from the Master. On the other hand, don't be gullible. Check out everything and keep only what's good. Throw out anything tainted with evil. You see, in the early church, they didn't have the full written canonized word like we do called the Bible. And so there were these New Testament prophets who would go from town to town and to preach. And they preached with the mind of God, or they preached the mind of God in the power of the Spirit of God. But it was very easy to imitate these guys, and many people did. So there was a natural aversion to prophets they did not know. So Paul is warning them and us, don't be cynical with people that you don't know that is preaching God's word, but don't be gullible either. Now, there's an early saying attributed to Jesus by early Christian writers, and one of them, Clement of Alexandria, this is what he says. He says, addressing this situation, become approved money changers who reject much but retain the good. What does he mean? He means that a money changer knew the genuine currency of his day. He could tell a counterfeit currency from a genuine one because he knew the genuine one so well. If there's ever a time, listen, if there is ever a time for you and me as followers of Jesus to be able to detect false gospel from true gospel, it is now. I mean, think about it. With this pandemic slowing everything down, churches and everybody else went to Facebook and YouTube overnight. On any given Sunday, you can watch all day if you wanted to, people preaching. You can listen to them, and you should listen to some of them, but you also need to examine what they say, just like the Bereans did with the Apostle Paul in Acts 17. We have to become experts in the true gospel so that we will know when someone is preaching a false gospel. Become approved money changers who reject much but retain the good. Real quickly, let me show you number 6, verse 22. Paul says, abstain from every form of evil. So we are to abstain from evil. It's always God's will for his people to abstain from every form of evil. Technically and grammatically speaking, this phrase probably does belong with the talk about prophecies and not listening to every form of prophecy that's given. But I think it's easy enough to see that this phrase, this sentence, can stand on its own just fine. Followers of Jesus are to abstain from evil. We are to avoid evil at all costs. In fact, Isaiah the prophet says in Isaiah 16 and 17, cease to do evil, learn to do good. God paid too high a price for us to cheapen his grace by running around with sin, right? We are to abstain from evil. It's always God's will for us to avoid evil at all cost. Now let me show you the final one. It's in verses 23 and 24. To depend on God. One of the seven ways, the last way, for us to follow God's will while we wait is to depend on God. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. So it's always God's will for his people to depend on him. In our spiritual walk, we do what we can do. We repent and we trust. And God does what only God can do. What is God's goal? He himself sanctifies us, and not just a little bit, but completely. Here's what that means. He makes us holy and he makes us holy. One's an H-O-L-Y, the other one is a W-H-O-L-L-Y. We are made whole and complete in our sanctification process. If you don't know what that word means, that's no problem. That just means that we're in a process by God that God is in charge of, and He is making us look like Jesus. And in fact, we can trust Him with this, because if it was up to us, we would surely mess it up, right? We would. And so we have this next part. But He's going to do all this to be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. That word "be kept" is a military word with connotations that something is guarded to keep it safe. What is God keeping safe? The work that He is doing in you. The process that He has you in of making you like Jesus, you don't have to worry about messing it up because God has got this. In fact, He tells us, "He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it." It's not only enough that He's faithful, but He follows it up with a promise. He's going to do it. God is a finisher of anything that He starts. So Paul writes in Philippians 1:6 that, "I am sure of this, that He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ." Your sanctification, your becoming like Jesus, that's not up to you. We repent, we turn from our evil ways, we humble ourselves before God, and we trust Him that Jesus has already paid the price, Jesus has already went to the cross, and Jesus is alive today. And as we do this same dance every time that we repent and we trust, we repent and we trust, through that, God begins to form the image of Jesus in you. It's His work. So our confidence is not in what we can do to make ourselves better people, but what Jesus has already done and what God has promised that He will do if you will let Him in your life. In fact, today I want to invite you into this relationship with God through Jesus. Is that Jesus has given you an offer like you've never heard before, or maybe you've never accepted it. Is that He came and He died for your sins and He is alive today, and He invites you into this relationship that is not based on anything that you have done or can do, but what He has already accomplished at the cross for you. If you want that kind of relationship with Jesus, then I want to invite you to go to our website at www.highlandbaptist.net. That's www.highlandbaptist.net. And a little green button you'll see is click, or it says "Yes to Jesus." Click that. There's a little form. Fill that short form out. It comes to me, and I would love to be able to follow up with you and what your decision is regarding your relationship with Jesus. And for all of the rest of us, I want to give us some encouragement this morning. As we've looked at all these seven ways that we can follow God's will while we wait, it all centers on that number seven, depend on God. So I'm going to ask the worship team, those who are going to help me, to go ahead and come on back up here. They're going to help me finish up with a song. And this will be kind of the closing of our service this morning. And I love this song. It's one of my favorite hymns. It's a newer hymn, but it's still nonetheless one of my favorite ones because it really talks about this last verse, or this last two verses that we just read about depending on God. Look, even when we don't think we're going to get it right, and even when we seem to mess up more than maybe we get right, guess what? God's got this. It's not up to you and it's not up to me. No one can snatch us out of His hand. God has got this. And so I know some of you may know this song, "Hold Me Fast." But instead of singing along, I want to invite you just to read the words on the screen and just prayerfully consider the truth of the gospel in this song. Again, this is "He Will Hold Me Fast."
Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, He will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold, my fearful pen, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. And those he saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast. And precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last, bought by him at such a cost. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Oh, oh. For my life he bled and died. Christ will hold me fast. And justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast and raise with him to endless life. He will hold me fast till my faith is turned to sight when he comes at last.
That's your prayer for today, that God will complete that work that he has begun in you. We want you to have a wonderful week. Can I pray with you before we are done? Let's pray together, and once we're done and say amen, then God bless and you have a wonderful week. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the day. We thank you for your mercies and your grace. We thank you for the hope that you give us and the confidence that we have that you will hold us fast. That no matter what life throws at us, no matter what is going on around us, God, you haven't given up on us. So God, we trust you and we look to you this week, that we would respond to this kind of grace at work in our life, that we would respond with joy and with peace
and with thanksgiving and with hands that look to serve and eyes that look for what you're doing around us and mouths that are quick to bless others. God, be with your people here at Highland. Continue to glorify yourself through us and the strength in our faith. And we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.